Hello, rocket fans, and welcome to another update from Copenhagen Suborbitals. Today, I'm going to tell you a little bit about how a rocket engine actually works. And to exemplify, I have brought this piece of beautiful machinery. This was a rocket engine. Now it's been cut up so that you can see how it works and how it's built on the inside. This is the actual engine that was placed in our Heat 2X rocket. Some of you might have seen the video we have on YouTube where the Heat 2X rocket burns in the test stand. And this is the engine we managed to salvage afterwards. So even though this is a rocket engine, it was a rocket engine that didn't work very well. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about that afterwards, why that was. So basically, there are several types of rocket engines. This is what you call a regeneratively cooled engine. That means that it is the fuel itself that cools the engine down while it's running. When you have combustion in a rocket engine, you are burning an oxidizer, in our case liquid oxygen, and a fuel, and in our case that is ethanol, or 75% ethanol and 25% water. The combustion takes place inside here in the combustion chamber, and once the rocket engine burns, it is over 2000 degrees hot in here, which means that the material the engine is made of, in this case ordinary steel, it won't last very long if it's not cooled. And the way you can cool a rocket engine is by pumping the fuel in the sides of the engine up here before it is injected into the engine. So if you look at some of the pipework up here, you can see on the back, well, you can see it, but I'm pointing right here on the back. There is a feed pipe, and this pipe is used to feed the fuel. It runs on the backside all the way down here, and then it feeds the fuel into this manifold down here. Then the fuel runs at very high speed up inside these small walls here in the engine. You can see the engine has an inner wall and an outer wall, and then this thin layer in between here, the fuel runs up the side and then it hits the injector, and then it is mixed with the liquid oxygen and then sprayed out into the engine. So when the engine runs, then the combustion and the heat generated by the combustion is cooled all the time by the liquid running by inside the engine. So you can say that the fuel of the engine is cooling the engine. This is actually very clever, but in this engine there's also implemented a second cooling mechanism, and that is the small holes that you can see here on the inside of the engine. The principle used here is also a very common one. What you do is simply that you allow a small portion of the fuel to run on the inside of the chamber walls, and that produces the same effect as, for example, if you want to feel if an electric hot plate is hot. You lick your fingers and then you just touch the plate carefully. What actually happens, why you don't burn your fingers, is because a very, very small thin layer of water vapor is created between your finger and the hot plate. And also, as the fluid evaporates, a lot of heat is taken away from the material. Remember, for those of you who have studied physics, temperature and heat are two very different things. What we're talking about here is not temperature, it is actually removing heat from the material. And to remove enough heat from the material on the inside here, you need to have a very large mass flow to take away that heat. So that is basically how the engine works and how it burns and how it is cooled. And then when you have the combustion in here, the engine narrows in what we call the throat down here. And what happens here is that the exhaust gases, all the combustion gases, are accelerated so that they leave the engine at a much higher speed. And that is one of the reasons why you see these nice diamonds when the exhaust leaves the engine, and that is actually what produces the thrust of the engine. That is the material leaving the engine, pushing it forwards. This engine, as you can see on the video that we will show you in a minute, didn't work as expected. When you look at this video, then you can see the engine in the test stand. Right now the engine is burning. We are in what we call pre-stage. And when we are in pre-stage, that means that just a small amount of fuel is put into the combustion chamber to start up the engine. And then, as you can see in a little while, when the main valve opens, which means that all the normal amount of fuel is let into the engine, then we have not an explosion, but a burn through, which means that simply all the fuel is dumped out of the engine. And what happens now is that all the fuel is dumped, and then the liquid oxygen can flow freely and just nurture the fire. So what you see on the video now is simply just a fire that is fed by pure oxygen. The reason why this engine failed is due to a design error, really, or maybe also some production methods that we didn't really anticipate. Basically, the only thing that holds together the inner and the outer wall here on the engine is the difference in pressure. And when you start this engine, the difference in pressure is very large. When you open the main valves, you have a very, very hot inside, and then you get what we call the water hammer effect. All of a sudden, all the fluid is pushed into the engine, and at the same time, the inside of the engine is very, very hot. So it simply just, as you can see here, it simply just collapses the inside of the engine, and that was what caused the big fire. So this is an engine design that we have tried in Copenhagen Suborbitals. This is an engine design that we are not using again. Currently, we are working on developing a big rocket engine for our speaker rocket that will use similar but not the same technology, and we will use different design methods to build it. But building and testing this engine was a very, very important step and gave us a lot of learnings in terms of getting it right the next time. When you build rocket engines and when you build rockets, it's all about testing, and you don't get it right every time. Sometimes we say that building rockets is 95% banging your head against the wall, and then 5% of the time you actually succeed. So I hope that you learned something today about how rocket engines work. Remember that Copenhagen Suborbitals is an all-volunteer non-profit project. All of us here work for free, which means that we rely solely on your donations and contributions to be able to produce all the rockets and all the fantastic video and imagery that we can share with you. So please go to our website, www.cupsup.com, and sign up as a Copenhagen Suborbitals supporter. Thank you, rocket fans.